and kick us off right now. I want to welcome you all to the very first Jazz Speaks that we've had in some time. This is a program made possible by the Whitaker Foundation. That we call Whitaker Jazz Speaks. And we're so grateful to the Whitaker Foundation for making this possible and for being flexible enough with us to allow us to pivot, as they say, to make sure that we could present these programs in this fashion. Of course, with COVID, we would have been presenting this in the club last spring, but unfortunately, with things working out the way they have, you know, we're bringing it to you live. But we have a fantastic show for you with an absolutely exceptional speaker, and we have a wonderful band. And I'm so glad that we're able to, you know, provide some work for the musicians here in St. Louis, because as you can imagine, this past year has been very hard on everybody in the entertainment business. But we're looking forward to people getting vaccinated and to coming back strong to have these in the future. Now, we do have two more Whitaker Jazz Speaks events coming up in the next month or so. On April 28th, Ashley Kahn is going to join us again for a presentation on Billy and Ella, of course, two of the most important singers of the past century. And then on May 26th, we're going to be presenting a program that we're calling Radiohead Runs the Voodoo Down, which is going to be about the influence of jazz on the music of Radiohead. And we hope that you will that you join us for that. Now, we do have a site on our website, so if you go to jazzftl.org/speaks, we're going to have links to those shows so you can get more information on that. And then we're also going to be posting the video from tonight's presentation for you, so that if you want to share that with somebody or you want to rewatch the lecture presentation and the concert, you'll be able to do that. So we're going to have our lecture with Ashley Kahn, as we usually do. We start off with a lecture, and then we have a concert. The concert's going to be a band led by Bob DeBoo on bass. Kendrick Smith will be on saxophone, Ben Patey on trumpet, Alan Ferber on trombone, Adam Manis on piano, and Montez Coleman on drums. So one thing I want to tell you before we get started with our presentation is that we will be taking questions throughout the presentation. So you don't have to wait until the end of the program. If you have a question, just put it in the Q&A down at the bottom of your screen. Just put that there, and we will answer those as they come up. But you don't need to wait until the end. We're going to take questions as they come up. And to talk about 1959, a year that changed jazz, we have a fantastic friend of Jazz St. Louis. We've had him to the club before, and we're looking to welcome him back. Ashley Kahn, author, educator, music journalist, concert producer. He's a professor of music history and criticism at NYU and lectures at other institutions as well. His books include A Love Supreme, the story of John Coltrane's signature album, Kind of Blue, one of my favorite books and one of my favorite albums. And we're going to hear a little bit more about that, Kind of Blue, the making of Miles Davis' masterpiece. And he's also a well-known speaker. You may have heard him on National Public Radio, or you may have seen his writing in publications like the Wall Street Journal or Rolling Stones. Ladies and gentlemen, it's my great pleasure to welcome back to St. Louis virtually the fabulous Ashley Kahn.
Thank you, Gene. Hi, everyone. It's a pleasure to be here once again, even virtually. And thank you so much for joining us. I know that there's such a challenge, especially by evening time, to not want to be in front of the screen. But I promise you at least an hour and a half to 2 hours of engaging, informative information about some great music that most of you, I'm sure, are aware of already. So we're hoping that you will gain new insights, deeper appreciation of some of these classics. 1959 is the window, the frame that we've kind of established for diving into four classic recordings. That's what's forthcoming. And as Gene said, you know, I would like to make this less of a lecture. I don't even like to use the word lecture, and have it much more of an interactive presentation kind of event, so that if there is if there are any questions or comments that come up during the process, we don't necessarily have to wait for the Q&A section at the very end, although there will be some time set aside for that. I'm going to take this at the kind of pace that I approach most of my course lectures at NYU. So if I'm going a little fast, you can also tell me, you know, slow it down. I want to focus on this point that you just made or whatever. But I do invite interactivity as far as these presentations go. There will be music. There'll be a lot of images. I've got a whole slideshow with which to present 1959 to you and try and explain some of the context and why we are still under the shadow of some of the incredible musical achievements of that year, 62 years later in 2021. I hope you guys are well and staying healthy and staying strong. This is not only a health challenge, but a spiritual challenge that we're all going through right now. And one of the great things that, and I say this every time that I talk to my students, is that the music community, not just jazz, but the musical community, has this built-in kind of support system, this idea that interconnection and being in touch with each other is a necessary component of being part of the music scene. And that is everyone, not just the music makers, but the music appreciators, the fans, all of you guys who are here today. So what I'm saying is that there's a spiritual benefit to being part of this conversation this evening as well. At least I hope so. You know, I'm in Arizona right now. I just want to give you a sense of context. That's the late afternoon Arizona sun, Tucson sun coming in through the window. But it is such a pleasure to be with you in St. Louis, and I hope the next time that we're talking, and it'll be face to face and, you know, in healthier and saner times. So let's get started. I'm going to share my screen. Travis, thank you for all the technical help in setting this up. Travis, we've done some tests to make sure everything here is going right. And let me make sure I'm doing this correctly. You should be seeing the slideshow now. There we go, 1959. Now, one thing I want to mention also at the outset is that I'm not going to try to be comprehensive about each and every classic album from this year. The whole idea is to really hit upon certain points that go a little bit deeper than what you might know already, but also to open the door for you to examine, explore it further yourself with a better understanding of what you're looking for and what you're listening to as you dive deeper into these classics. These are incredible pieces of music that are still with us, as I mentioned before. And there's this, you know, kind of question that is always hovering around 1959. Why? What happened in 1959? Why 1959? And I'd like to come back to this question at the very end and see if it'll make a lot more sense after we have spoken not only about the year, but also about these four classic albums. So keep that in mind. We're going to come back to it at the very end. Why 1959? Few things about 1959 that I think we should mention is like the historical context, what was going on. The Cold War was still happening. That's Nikita Khrushchev, you know, the head of the USSR on the upper left there, who was bringing in a very sort of like, you know, the drama of the Cold War. It wasn't just this hidden fear anymore. It was it was out in the open and was a sort of PR marketing war battle going on between the US and USSR. And this is a very important twist in the way that the Cold War was being handled, and it'll have an effect on the Dave Brubeck album. Cuba has just, experienced a revolution, and Castro has taken over, and that is still something we're dealing with, 62 years later, the after effects of that sort of encroachment into the Western Hemisphere of communism and communist thinking. Rock and roll is happening in a big way, where rock stars who are dying are making headlines. And I don't know if any of you out there are familiar with the Cape Man story, which was basically a turf war between gangs on the Upper West Side of Manhattan. This is what West Side Story is based on. And this was one of the big headlines, like, how could this happen in a civilized New York City, at the time? So this is sort of all the stories, the lead stories of 1959, the leading films. It's still the studios are in charge. You've got this incredible Ben-Hur epic, of Rome, right around the time that Christianity was being introduced into the Roman Empire. And then the number two film that year is about two jazz musicians who are on the run from the mob and are cross-dressing and trying to get away. So this is, again, the kind of contextual information of what's happening in 1959. Musically, the mainstream. I mean, you can't get past, Elvis, Frank, Bobby Darin. These were the big hit makers of that year in 1959. Coming over from the R&B side, on one side you've got one of the kings of rock and roll, one of the pioneers, Bo Diddley, and Ray Charles had his one of his biggest, definitely his breakthrough hit, What I Say, which was gospel music. And if you think about the power of black gospel music and the impact it's going to have in the decade to come in the 60s, these are the pre-echoes. This is, Ray Charles and the Isley Brothers doing Shout. This is music that's coming straight out of the black church, and this is setting up the stage for the Rolling Stones, the Beatles, and the rock explosion. A much different approach to rock than what was happening in the 50s. And of course, doo-wop, and the Flamingos, all the bird bands, of that era are happening in a big way. In the world of jazz, we have many contenders for what would be classics from this year, including Ella's Gershwin Songbook, The Genius of Ray Charles, which was taking Ray Charles's sort of R&B gospel-influenced sound and marrying it to a Count Basie big band kind of feel. Duke Ellington's best-known work as far as film, doing a film score, Anatomy of a Murder, and he actually appears in the film with Jimmy Stewart. But the four that kind of rise to the top and the four that we're going to deal with right now over the next 45 minutes are these four albums. We're going to hear little bits and pieces of each of them. What do these four have in common? Well, they're all different explorations of kind of post-bebop language, modern jazz, where modern jazz is by the end of the 50s. If Charlie Parker and Dizzy Gillespie kind of like drop the bomb of bebop and get the whole musical world, not just the jazz world, but the whole musical world to like start rethinking about how to approach harmony, how to approach rhythm in 1945, this is almost exactly 15 years later. And these are four different approaches to taking that idea, that basic idea that Charlie Parker and Dizzy Gillespie put forward, not just ideas, but freedoms in how to approach jazz music and improvised music in general, and four different ways of dealing with it 15 years later. All four of them are incredible top-tier modern jazz legends, To this day, you know, if you ask someone on the street to mention a jazz artist amongst the top 10, will be Ornette Coleman, Miles Davis, Dave Brubeck, and Charles Mingus. As well, there's nothing but original music on all four albums. No ballads, no standard blues material, no familiar stuff. This is all very, very new music. That's very important. There's no classics here that are leaning on material that's coming up from the past. This is all newly written, composed music throughout all four albums. And then finally, you know, the idea that each one of these has a story. And one of the, you know, as a writer, I can tell you that there's this theory that in all stories fit into one of two categories. Either a man goes on a journey, or an individual goes on a journey, or a stranger comes into town. And of course, that's, you know, there are other stories too. But this, the idea of these general tropes in storytelling, at least two of these albums fit directly into one or the other. And so we'll get started with that right now. Oh, and by the way, I should add that, you know, to this day, each one of these albums is blessed with some really deep, insightful, and informative information that you can get off the liner notes. I know we are like deep inside this age of streaming right now, in which even credits, even knowing who the sidemen are, this information is kind of being pulled away from the music. And I just wanted to show you that, you know, all of these albums, the record companies that were putting it out, the people who were producing these packages in which to present the music, took the time to find the words and construct a really helpful essay with which to frame this music, with which to better introduce this music to a public in 1959. I wish that things were still this way, but you know, the shift right now from physical formats, LPs and CDs, to streaming in a big way, this is the one thing that I most bemoan, is the fact that all this information is kind of being pulled away. On the other side, we do have the internet. There's Google. You know, so you can do some deep diving yourself to find out, oh, let me find out more about this music that I just heard for the first time last week.
Yeah, however, I do appreciate that shout out. I do appreciate that shout out for the line.
Thank you, Gene. You know, I mean, growing up, you know, and getting into this music for the first time, it was me listening and like reading the liner notes, you know, and I mean, down to the point of like who the engineer was, what studio it was recorded in. There's stuff to be known, you know, in all that information. So if you can get a hold, if you do want to explore these classic recordings any further, and you haven't encountered these essays, please do, especially Bill Evans's. This is the pianist working with Miles on Kind of Blue. His own approach to writing an essay to explain the music on this experimental project, it, for me, was mind-blowing and career-changing. You know, it really helped me understand that there is a deep value to having this information shared. Number one, chapter one of our deep dive into 1959 involves a man going on a journey. As I said, you know, it's the story of someone taking a journey, in this case, helped along by the US government. The State Department sponsored tours of jazz artists that was very becoming commonplace in the 1950s. Dizzy Gillespie, Louis Armstrong, and Dave Brubeck. And I mention this because without that 1958 tour that Dave Brubeck does over in the Middle and Far East, we wouldn't have this album. Point number one about this classic. it really comes from the idea of, in the Cold War, that jazz could be used as a weapon, as a tool, in this PR war between the capitalist West and the communist East, you know, between US and USSR. What a concept, right? It didn't last too long. However, the State Department, especially through Jazz at Lincoln Center in New York, still does do touring. You know, I'm talking pre-pandemic, of course. But, you know, it comes and goes, and a lot of it has to depend on the kind of political temperature at the time, you know, who's in office. But the whole State Department tours began with a Republican, began with Dwight Eisenhower in the House, or in the White House, and Richard Nixon as the vice president, and he was very much geared towards this. Apparently Nixon was very supportive of this idea of the State Department tours. So here's, you know, the idea of the Dave Brubeck Quartet, the classic Dave Brubeck Quartet, which is a cross-racial unit. Eugene right there on bass, the general. Joe Morello with the dark glasses on next to his wife on drums, and the great Paul Desmond on alto sax all the way to the right in the dark suit. Dave's right, our left. Coming off the plane, the interaction between Dave Brubeck and various musicians in each of these countries. Now, I want you to take a look at these countries that he went to. Can you imagine an artist going through these countries today? I mean, this is 1958, just before the political turmoil that has, this has been sort of like the fault line, and it's also the oil producing region of the world, but it's the fault line, the political fault line between the East and the West, even to this day, you know. And Dave Brubeck gets there just before the real unrest starts to happen and has yet to really subside. Turmoil and oil, you know, they kind of unfortunately go together. But during that moment, that little window of time in 1958, Dave Brubeck has his head turned around by these incredible time rhythm signatures, these times that are part of the culture in each of these countries. The idea of this tune in particular, pulling from Turkey, which is the first stop on this, actually Poland was the first stop. The first stop in the Far East, in the Middle East rather, was Turkey. And in Turkey, he meets a time signature that is 9-8. It's referred to as a Turkish aksak rhythm. And he decides to kind of marry it to a tune that he's working on. And what I'm going to do is play you a bit of it right now. And what he's doing, this is the part, everybody knows the introduction of Blue Rondo a la Turk. But the part where he stops the 9-8 time and allows it to, like, the swing jazz to kind of creep in for a moment and come back out of it, for me, that's when he's really proving the point that music is a bridge. Music is this incredible opportunity to build bridges between cultures that are often thought of as being too far apart to even consider finding a way of getting them to work together. Let's hear it now. Blue Rondo a la Turk, little excerpt.
Thank you.
that the dialogue continues, you know. This was very, very strange for 1959. This was so, I mean, anything in 9/8 just sounds so foreign and weird. According to the musicians I've spoken to from the 50s who, you know, were in New York at the time, he goes, the coolest time signatures, if you really wanted to hear something, you had to go to like an Indian restaurant or Afghani restaurant, etc. That's where you would find musicians who would actually be performing while you were eating, you know, but trying to find it even in the record stores was nothing that was readily available, you know, long before the internet, long before the idea of having all this music being released by labels over here in America. But having it in your face and being immersed in it, as Dave Brubeck was when he went on this 1958 State Department tour, there was no way that he couldn't respond to it. And that tune especially, but especially when he goes in and out of that swing time, it for me just says it all, you know, of what he was trying to accomplish. Now, of course, we cannot talk about Time Out and not mention the best-selling single, jazz single of all time, Take Five. Take Five is, of course, a tune that is in 5/4 time. It was actually even before the trip. Joe Morello is the guy who is inspiring this. He's been working on 5/4 time and wanting to do something with it. And I just love this idea that Dave's quartet was not just Dave's quartet, but that everybody could bring different elements into it and add to the stew, the creative, you know, effort that was being done collectively. And so the idea of this quartet being a collective really comes through in a tune like this. One of the understated things that happens in this tune is that Joe Morello earns his moment on a pop hit, a jazz drum solo that is extended, that takes its time. And I thought that to give Joe his, you know, his props here, I think I would like to play that segment of Take Five and just listen to how he is, you know, he's still swinging, but he's also kind of teaching the audience, teaching the American listener in 1959 how to count in 5/4. Yeah. that's a Paul Desmond melody, and as you can see, because copyrights are not, you can't copyright a rhythm, you know, to this day, but you can copyright melody. And so Paul Desmond gets the credit on this. It's Brubeck's genius to find a way to take Morello's idea of 5-4, connected to Desmond's, these two melodic ideas that he's created. And he actually reverses them, you know, it was supposed to be A and B, and, you know, the B becomes the A in the way that they approach the structure of this tune. To this day, Paul Desmond, by the way, just a side note here on Take Five. Take Five is still so popular that when Paul Desmond passed away, he had no family. He didn't have any children or whatever, but to leave his songwriting royalties to, but he left it to the American Red Cross. To this day, the American Red Cross gets about $100,000 a year from just Take Five. I don't know what the rest of Paul Desmond's songwriting, you know, copyright, you know, royalties amount to, but just from this one tune, the Red Cross still gets 100 grand a year from this tune. So before I go forward, any questions, any comments?
Good. I think we can move on to the next one.
All right. By the way, if you want to go further, I'm going to suggest a book that for each of these albums. Jazz Diplomacy is all about the state tours, and you recognize this photo again, but by Lisa Davenport did such a great job of researching the whole, you know, idea of the State Department tours in the 1950s into the 60s, the achievements, the accomplishments that came out of them. On to our second story, A Stranger Comes to Town. This is the sound of Los Angeles. This is not the sound of New York. This music was created, and Ornette becomes Ornette in Los Angeles. And his appearance in 1959, especially at the Five Spot, and a long run at this very experimental, you know, sort of bohemian East Village hotspot where Thelonious Monk had made such an impact when John Coltrane was in the group just a year before. This is really the sort of breakthrough for the idea that something might be happening in some other place than the Big Apple. You know, in New York often is thought of the place where all music moves forward when it comes to jazz. But really, I mean, it is, you know, where bebop was born, but it really kind of challenged that idea that everything of value does not necessarily begin in New York City. There were other reasons too for why this would become a both pivotal but a very controversial album. And it wasn't just the sound, it was also the idea of daring to name your album The Shape of Jazz to Come. I mean, you better be ready to deliver on a promise like that. And, you know, other Ornette album titles reflected this kind of bravado, the change of the century, you know, etc. Especially at this moment from 58, when he's recording for Contemporary Records, 59, he makes it over to New York and starts recording for Atlantic, and then in the 60 and 61. This breakthrough years, this is the album that really stands at that pivot point when the world says, are we going to go with this? Are we not? Are we going to accept these changes or not? And the thing is that many musicians did. John Lewis of the Modern Jazz Quartet, Cannonball Adderley, they all ended up fans of Ornette Coleman. And the fact that these musicians were respecting and supporting what he was doing meant a lot of other people, especially the critics, had to pay close attention. And this was one of the most challenging things to happen to the music since Charlie Parker back in the 40s. So we have A Stranger Coming to Town with some strange music. A lot of it has to be explained by the fact that he doesn't arrive just with music. He arrives with his own band. It's a band that he has been working with in Los Angeles that includes Don Cherry on trumpet, on cornet, rather, Charlie Hayden on bass, Billy Higgins on drums, also Ed Blackwell. But this was the sort of like a little conclave there in Los Angeles of experimental music. What about the music? So a lot of it has to do with Ornette and his conception. A lot of it has to do with the musicians that he has sort of surrounded himself with and who have come to know each other almost on a telepathic level. They know what to expect from each other. There's another thing about Ornette's music that Ornette himself would talk about again and again and again throughout his career. And this is, kind of a examination too of the titles that, you know, who in 1959 was calling tunes like Focus on Sanity, Congeniality, Chronology. I mean, these are ideas, general ideas, to apply them to jazz means he's coming from a certain place, a spiritual place even, that is not there yet. You know, John Coltrane will not be developing his kind of spirituality for another 4 or 5 years. But Ornette is helping to open that door. Sun Ra, at the same time, helping to open the door, even in the titles that they choose for their music. This is Ornette talking about his music, what's different about it. And he keeps talking about the human quality, the warmth of the human voice. And he wants to get this in the music. This is Lonely Woman from the Shape of Jazz to Come. So perfect musically. And in fact, he focuses on that, the cracks and the kind of intonation freedom, if you will, the idea that he can go a little bit off key. He can make it sound more vocal than you normally would in the idea of a polished jazz performance. And he not only focuses on this, but he elevates this into becoming one of the main elements in his music. And he encourages the musicians, like Charlie Hayden with that, you know, the way that he's playing the bass and the glissando that he keeps putting in on the notes. And also Don Cherry's, playing with intonation as well. As far as the musical technique, as far as the kind of nuts and bolts of the music, here's Charlie Hayden talking about what's going on, which is a continuation of the freedoms of bebop. And he's talking about the chord structures and stuff. So there's a new sense of freedom here. If bebop is about knowing the chord changes and following the chord changes, finding the freedom within the chord changes, what if you actually have a freedom to change the changes in the midst of a performance? Well, one of the things that he doesn't mention here is that it certainly helps if the musicians are, one, very comfortable with this kind of new approach, and two, if they know each other. And once again, I think that's been a key to all of Ornette's achievements, is having a band that is both of the same mind and that has had a lot of practice, that if they've worked stuff out together. But think of this with this kind of freedom, and we'll hear a little bit of Congeniality. This is a snippet of that tune. These are very short snippets, and I encourage you to take these ideas, especially this idea of like the emotional element that Ornette is talking about, and the more technical element of the music, that both were there and both were a very important part of understanding what Ornette's music was like. But it created a sound that really was so unique. And it survived in New York and became kind of woven into the sound of New York for many decades to come afterwards. And I remember when I arrived in New York in the late 1970s as a college student, Old and New Dreams, which was the surviving members of Ornette's, you know, breakthrough groups of the late 50s and early 60s, that they were like at the top of the scene. And everybody was looking to them for what was going on. So Ornette's impact cannot be overstated, especially coming out of 1959, and that's his year. Mm-hmm. I know, go ahead.
We do have a question from Steve, who wanted to know if he was commercially successful as any of the other two.
The question of commercial success in 1959 for a jazz musician is a very loose thing. You know, if you're selling 20,000-30,000 units, you're doing okay. And Atlantic had a strong presence. It was a mid-range label. They had, of course, Ray Charles and success with Bobby Darin, etc. So he had a machine behind him. And he was able to get a certain level of success. I wouldn't say it was incredibly, it was a commercial success, let's say, on the same level of Miles Davis at Columbia at the time. But I would say that at least on a marketing level, on a PR level, and being able to get recognized and talked about, and work, you know, in other words, come over from Los Angeles, find a place to stay, an apartment, have constant work. On that level, I would say yes, then he was a success. This most recent book on Ornette, The Territory and the Adventure, by the woman who used to run Caravan of Dreams, the venue that Ornette had started in Fort Worth back in the 80s, has a wonderful couple of chapters on the Los Angeles years. And so to understand how Ornette becomes Ornette, she traces the Fort Worth, Texas to LA journey really, really well. And to understand how Ornette came to be someone who would call his album The Shape of Jazz to Come, I strongly recommend this book. I know we're running out of time, and I'm going to keep charging forward. We okay, Gene? Great.
Good to go.
Okay. Mingus, you know, which is kind of a play on Latin, schoolboy Latin. It's the declination of the adjective Mingus, which, you know, is obviously Charles Mingus's last name. You know, if we have any Latin scholars out there, it's really weird because the root from which Mingus would come, if it was indeed a Latin term, is mungere, which is Latin for to piss or to urinate. So it's both sophisticated and street at the same time, but it's Mingus is the male. Minga is the friend is the female declination, and Mingum is the neuter declination of the adjective. This is, you know, we've had the story of someone who goes on a journey, a story of someone, a stranger coming to town. This is a story of a man looking at himself and taking himself apart into his pieces. And pieces of a man, you know, that's Mingus. The self-examination, the idea of celebrating what he knows, that will always be part of Mingus's kind of approach to his music. And he wants to tell you who he is. And who he is the product of, you know, his ancestors. And this is an album that is a celebration of the ancestors. It's the celebration of a man who is African American. Actually, he's multi-ethnic. You know, he's got Mexican roots, white roots, and African American roots. Here he is actually in the studio at the Columbia Records studio recording this very album. And here are the titles that kind of let you know the pieces of Mingus that are going to be celebrated on this album. He's, you know, obviously a student of Duke Ellington's, of Lester Young's. Goodbye Pork Pie Hat is a dedication to Lester Young. Jelly Roll Morton, you know, is celebrating one of the tunes. The idea of black church music is the kickoff tune for the whole album. And the idea of going from Sunday morning worship kind of intensity in black gospel music to Saturday night celebration party music is what Boogie Stop Shuffle is all about. I'm gonna have you guys hear a comparison of the intensity from Saturday night into Sunday morning right now. This is a snippet of Boogie Stop Shuffle into Better Get It in Your Soul. We'll be right back. sense of community music. That's what's coming across there, is this idea of within the septet, the octet that Mingus has. That includes Booker Irvin, Shafi Hadi and John Handy on saxophones, Willie Dennis and Jimmy Nepper on trombones, Horace Parlin, of course, on piano, and the great Danny Richmond, DR, the doctor, on drums, who was came out of the R&B world and was part of Mingus's group for many, many years. He is celebrating this idea of African-American community, at least on these two tunes, but also, you know, showing who he is and who he's responding to in his world. And in the middle of all this, all of these African-American heroes, etc., there's a white guy. And this white guy is a governor. And you can examine this further. I don't have that much time to go into it. But of course, the root of protest music in jazz goes back to Strange Fruit and before. But this is absolutely Mingus responding to the moment, that historical moment, just before the civil rights era really gets started. And he is absolutely outraged by what he's seeing down south. And as you know, we have seen in recent years, it ain't just down south. It's still here, so unbelievably entrenched in the American experience, this idea of systemic racism, etc. And Mingus is going to talk about it, and he's going to sing about it, and he's going to write a tune about it and have his band play about it, but Columbia won't let him. Fables of Phoebus is an instrumental number. It'll take one more year into 1960 when, and Mingus has his own label happening at the same time, but he gets with Candid, a small record label out of New York, and he does the original Phoebus Fables, which is the tune that he wanted to do for this album, with the lyric about this governor who was all about non-integration, about holding back on the time and the changes that were trying to happen in the South. Governor Orville Phoebus, by the way, was from Arkansas. I should have mentioned that. What I want to do is play you the Columbia Records version, which is Fables of Phoebus, instrumental, and we'll take it into 1960 when we can hear Mingus's words, which are an important part of this tune. This is basically what he's doing to Phoebus. It's like, let me take his name, but reduce him to what he is, which is this little footnote historic joke, you know, that he should be, you know, reduced to. And unfortunately, that line that always comes back, 2, 4, 6, 8, we want to teach you hate. And that reduction of everything that is going on in the country then through the 60s, and unfortunately now, is really what it, you know, I mean, Mingus had his finger right on that button, you know, so much so that his record label kind of retreated and said, look, we'll let you put the tune on, we'll let you call it Fables of Faubus, but Mingus had to wait till the next year to redo the tune with the true message that he wanted to convey, coming from the African-American experience of the time. And there we have Mingus Ah-Um, one of the most important albums to hear from 59, and also a key to understanding what Mingus was about. Mingus, the idea of being the self-reflective artist, the idea of him showing you who he is from so many different perspectives. One of the classic examples of this is, of course, Beneath the Underdog, Charles Mingus's own memoirs, which is a must read for anyone who wants to really understand, you know, where modern jazz comes from, but also understand the genius of this particular gentleman. And now we get to chapter 4, and I know that, again, time's getting tight, and I do want to get to the live music, so all of you guys, please hang in there. Of course, Kind of Blue, you know, the number one best-selling acoustic jazz album of all time. It's known for many things. The idea of the one-take approach, first take, first idea, best idea, which was not exactly true in the case of the five tunes on the album. But for the most part, it was, you know, that the first complete take is what Miles said. That's it. That's what we're taking from this session and putting out on the album. The other aspect of it is the, you know, Q-Tip from Tribe Called Quest. He likes to, he refers to these guys, this band, this particular sextet, as the Justice League of jazz. And I can't argue with that. You know, it is absolutely one of the most all-star collections within one band of all time in jazz. John Coltrane, Cannonball Adderley, Bill Evans on piano, as well as Wynton Kelly, and Jimmy Cobb on drums, and the late great Paul Chambers on bass. Absolutely one of those had this band not been together like this, I don't think the album would have achieved the heights that it did. There's the other, another aspect is that it introduced the idea of modal jazz, which was a shift away from the kind of slaloming effect of bebop, the idea that everyone was getting so used to and familiar with the language of bebop by this time, that there was a lot of like repetition of ideas. And Miles was getting, you know, he talks about this in an interview from 58. It's starting to sound too much the same. I need something different. And so by reducing the harmonic information that is given to the musicians, it demands a certain involvement and personal kind of statement on the part of each of the soloists that leads to more personal invention. The idea of bringing out who you are in your musical statements. And he really does that. We're going to hear an example of that right now. One of the discoveries when I did my book on Kind of Blue that just knocked me out was finding the actual scales upon which Flamenco Sketches, which is really the most modal, purely modal, of the jazz compositions on Kind of Blue, the five scales that defined each of the solo statements by the various members of the group. One of my favorite solo statements by John Coltrane of all time is his solo on Flamenco Sketches from Kind of Blue. I want to play that for you now. You can follow the scales that he goes through, the modes, hence modal jazz. And this is the only instruction he had. So the usual, Coltrane being usually lugubrious and having a lot to say in his solos, he's still in the middle of his sheets of sound period, he's got to stop and think. And you can hear, you can feel that kind of care taking place. And yet he remains so inventive and has this lyric quality that is just amazing. John Coltrane, Flamenco Sketches. You can see that on this music stand. This is Cannonball Adderley's. It says alto, you know, play sound of these scales. I love Bill's instruction. He doesn't say play exactly these scales. He says play the sound of these scales. And that fourth scale, by the way, is the scale that really gives it that kind of Iberian Spanish flamenco flavor. And if you listen very closely back to Coltrane's solo, you can hear that, you know, the beginnings of his Olé album, which will be his further exploration of this idea, of this Iberian feel, is going to come up. He doesn't want to let it go. And so the Olé album that he does for Atlantic. You can also see, by the way, on the music stand, his reeds, Cannonball's reeds, his sugar substitute, he was a diabetic, his mouthpiece cover, and he was also a migraine sufferer, so he has Bufferin and some sort of prescribed medicine there. And as a migraine sufferer too, you know, you want to have your medication close to you. The last thing I want to talk about, and this is, what is the story of Kind of Blue? You know, Miles was always not one to give up much in interviews. But when he did talk about Kind of Blue, there was one statement he once made about how, you know, it's about being black in America. It's about the African-American experience. And, pardon me, you know, you think about Miles is credited for being part of the birth of the cool. The idea of bringing this coolness. Well, what is cool? And I kept thinking about some of the studies that I had done, you know, this is going back to late 70s at Columbia. And there's this one incredible essay from 1975 done by Robert Ferris Thompson. And it's called An Aesthetic of Cool. Professor Robert Ferris Thompson is still with us. His expertise is actually in African art, visual art. And yet he proposes in this very, very seminal essay, this essay is quoted by all scholars of African culture, African American culture, etc. What is cool? It's an amazing essay. This, you know, these two sentences here are central to the idea that he explores. And many African-American scholars look to this essay as a sort of beginning point to trying to describe why cool is so important, and that cool is not just about a stance or style or the way you talk or the way you walk, but it's how you behave and how you can continue to be yourself in one of the most challenging experiences of modern history, which is what it's been like for African Americans for the last 400 years. So in this sense, I propose that Kind of Blue really is a story of a people. And when you think of cool and the idea of how you behave and how you, you know, project who you are in the midst of the craziness that is the American experience, I think of Miles Davis and I think about this one solo. And think about this when you hear his trumpet solo from So What. Somebody went and wrote a book about this album. To this day, I'm very proud of being of having had the opportunity to do that, to delve deeper into it. But you know, I can assure you that my thinking about this album and researching it and considering it from so many different angles has never stopped. And so the connection to the Robert Ferris Thompson essay and the whole concept of what cool is coming out of Yoruba culture in West Africa and how it was a survival mechanism, absolutely, in African American experience of the past 400 years, but how it comes through one of the most celebrated trumpet solos of all time. Just go on YouTube and see how many people are doing it themselves and taking it apart and redoing it again and again. It has become, the solos are as important as the compositions off of Kind of Blue. I promised to come back to 1959 and talk about, you know, why 1959. I honestly believe that what happened in 1959 is that the audience and that the listeners and that the community around the music caught up with the musicians. These albums all represented some of the most experimental jazz happening, groundbreaking jazz happening at that moment. The fact that, as that one attendee, you know, brought up, was it a commercial success? To the degree that jazz albums were commercial successes in 1959, yes, they were all standout, popular recordings that penetrated radio, that penetrated the media of the day, all the magazines of the day, and that remain with us today. And the audience was right there with him. That doesn't always happen. And I think that helped elevate both the music and the appreciation and the enduring quality of this music. What it says to me, however, is that, in 1959, had you asked anyone, are these four albums going to still be around and being talked about 62 years from now? No, But what we need to do is pay attention because 2021 might be another 1959. So the message of this whole kind of approach to thinking about 59 as a frame for music, I believe, is that there's always a possibility of another classic happening right now in, on YouTube in this case, or on Spotify or whatever. And that's the message I want to leave you with, is that there will always be classics being made. Why it all happens at the same time, I think it has a lot, like I said, it has a lot to do with the support and this idea of a scene, being there to support it along. And that's what we need to, that's our responsibility as well as the musicians, that we're all in this together to help make this music happen and to continue to move it forward.
All right. Well, Ashley, man, we can't thank you enough. It's been a wonderful walk through these four incredible albums. We have something from Logan here. Thank you so much for this incredibly insightful presentation. Can you speak on Wynton Kelly's contribution to Kind of Blue? Is there a more purifying moment in music than when Jimmy Cobb opens the floodgates with the help of his hi-hat for Wynton Kelly to play one of the most swinging, soulful solos ever recorded?
Well, I see that there are two questions there, Logan. And the second one is no, I don't think so. I mean, having been honored to know and get to know Jimmy Cobb, the late Jimmy Cobb, he to him it was just the right thing to do at the time, and he was someone who was always wanting to support the music in with minimal gesture. I mean, talk about another kind of example of cool in process. Jimmy Cobb's approach to the drum kit was not about flash or overstatement or whatever, but when he wanted to make a statement, that splash that he hits just before Miles or as Miles' solo begins is like the kickoff to the album. It's the kickoff to a whole new era in modern jazz. And it was just that he had done it so many times that he knew that was the right thing to do at that moment. As far as the other question, Wynton's, the way Wynton approaches Freddie Freeloader, which is his tune, his kind of star turn on Kind of Blue, it's almost like it was written for him, because it's a very up and joyful, buoyant kind of feel, as opposed to the kind of almost melancholic mood that pervades the other four tunes, especially Blue and Green. But there's a kind of reduced emotional import in the other four tracks. But Freddie Freeloader is bubbly and buoyant, and that's all about Wynton. Notice how much time that Miles gives him there, how much room he gives for Wynton to kind of make that tune his own. Thank you for bringing that up, Logan.
And then I think this will probably be our final question for the night. Tony wants to know what did the band make money-wise from the release of Kind of Blue?
I think that band made the same that every other band was making at that day. The way that the structure, the economic structure of being a side band was that you made a union minimum. And you're still, remember, they're still coming out of the 78 RPM era when every session was usually four tracks, two sides of two different 78 RPMs. discs. So the structure, the economic structure of how Cyban made money was very much by union minimum. Somewhere I have the figures. I mean, the figures are in my book on Kind of Blue, but it wasn't that much. And it was a one-time payment, you know, work for hire is the way that it was approached back then. So the Cybermen did not participate in future royalties. The leader did.
Well, fantastic. And I do encourage you all to pick up that book because it's wonderful. Kind of Blue is, of course, one of the most iconic albums in jazz. And to get behind the scenes look at it is really a treat. And for me, it was just so exciting to hear all the stories about how that fantastic album was put together. So Ashley, man, I'll tell you what, thank you so much. We're really looking forward to having you back here in a couple weeks to talk about Billie Holiday and Ella Fitzgerald. And you know, we thank you very much. We also want people to stick around because we've got a wonderful concert that is going to feature music from these four albums and with this fantastic band that we have of Bob DeBoo on bass, Kendrick Smith on saxophone, Ben Pai on trumpet, Alan Ferber on trombone, Adam Manis on piano, and Montez Coleman on drums. Thank you once again to the Whitaker Foundation for making the Whitaker Jazz Speak series possible. And we look forward to seeing you again. I hope you guys enjoy the show.
Thanks, everyone. Thank you.
That was Ornette Coleman's Congeniality. Please give it up for Ben Payee on the trumpet. This is Kendrick Smith on the saxophone. Ornette on the drums. Montez Coleman on the drums. Ornette's brother. My nephew. My name is Bob DeBoo on the bass. Very glad to be here playing the music of 1959. This is from Ornette Coleman's great album, The Shape of Jazz to Come. As I said, that previous composition was Congeniality. And now we're going to play a piece entitled Peace. Thank you. Hello again. Now we've moved on to Dave Brubeck's Time Out. That was a composition by Mr. Brubeck entitled Kathy's Waltz. This is Adam Manis on the piano. Again, this is Montez Coleman on the drums. Now we're going to invite up to the stage my friend Kendrick Smith to come play Everybody's Jumpin'. And as he's coming up, this is both of these songs are, of course, from Dave Brubeck's Time Out album. So we're changing our instrumentation to suit the album. And here we go. We're going to play Everybody's Jumpin'. Hope you like it. Thank you. That was So What, of course, by the great Miles Davis off of the Kinda Blue album. Back up on the stage, we have Adam Annis on the piano. Woo! Ben Payee on the trumpet. Kendrick Smith on the straight alto saxophone. On the drums, we have Montez Coleman. And welcoming to the stage, Mr. Alan Ferber on the trombone. Now we're going to move into some of Charles Mingus's music from Mingus Ah-Um.
Thank you.
Yes, that was Charles Mingus's Better Get Hit in Your Soul from Mingus A-Um. We're going to move into Self-Portrait in Three Colors, beautiful ballad written by Mr. Mingus. Then we're going to close out with Jelly Roll, written for Jelly Roll Morton. So once again, this is Adam Maniffs on the piano, Ben Paye on the trumpet, Kendrick Smith on the saxophone, Alan Ferber on trombone, Montez Coleman on the drums. My name is Bob DeBoo.